Today's project is to analyze and then hopefully correct a problem with the HF installation here in the Q-mobile. A project that I am making considerably more difficult by trying to document it using the phone and the gimbal system as the recording. So let's go see what the problem is first. I'll tell you what, before doing that, just a quick look at what the HF installation is. Obviously there's the control head stack, which includes the ICOM 7000, which is the HF radio. There is the body of the radio, which normally sits under the seat, but I've got it pulled out for convenience of testing things. And of course the antenna, which is the Tarheel 200 on the custom mount. And if you're wondering why is the antenna bent a little bit forward, why is the whip part of the antenna bent a little bit forward, it is so that when I'm driving down the highway, it is more or less straight up. And that's a lie. It's bent forward because I backed into the garage with the antenna still, the whip still on the base of the antenna, and it bent it way forward, and I bent it back partway, and then I said that's far enough. And I've got this little power supply feeding the electrical system of the car, so I don't have to have the engine running and still can operate at 13.8 volts. So the TLDR of the problem is that the radio is shutting down when I try to operate on 40 meters. And everything else works fine. And of course, over the course of the, what, 17 years that this vehicle and mobile installation has been in operation, everything has been fine. But a couple of months ago, suddenly, I couldn't operate 40 meters. All the other bands are good. And sending out a little bit of RF just a little above and below 40 meters, even that works. So something about 40 meters is the problem. And let me show you what that looks like. I'm going to start here at 10 meters and show you a interesting and handy feature of the ICOM 7000. And I think some of the other radios have this feature now too. You switch into a little graph of your SWR, and you feed that graph by pushing this F1 button and watch the frequency of the display and the little bars that show up. Every time I click the mic, it sends out a little burst of RF and then steps up the band. Click the mic again at each point and you draw a graph of your SWR. And here on 10 meters, the antenna is very broad-banded, so it's all, if you're in the green, you're below 2:1. On 20 meters, the antenna is still pretty broad-banded, but I found a setting where you could at least see a little bit of slope to the SWR curve. As I draw it by clicking the button, you can see that the SWR is dropping a little bit toward the high end of the band, which indicates that the antenna is too long. It wants to resonate on a lower frequency, longer antenna. So I can adjust it with the Tarheel antenna programmable antenna controller. And then get right in the middle where we want to be and trim up the antenna a little bit. So our SWR is just a little below 2:1, which is really adequate. Everybody hates the idea of 2:1, but it's really adequate. I don't know if you can hear the background noise. My neighbor across the street decided this would be a good day to clean out their garage using their leaf blower. I have switched the microphone to noise-canceling mode. Maybe you can't hear it. They just turned it off. And we have airplanes flying over all day because we're under the flight path of the Charlotte Airport. Anyway, here's a band where the antenna's bandwidth is considerably narrower, 80 meters. It's only about 20 kilohertz wide here. Let's take a look at the SWR curve that this draws. So we can see that the antenna is best, not great, but best at a little bit lower frequency. So we need to make the antenna a little bit shorter. And if this works, I can get it to be sending some RF out there. Shorten up the antenna, and sure enough, there's a good spot right there. And now we'll run the test across the whole band again and see that we're got a very tight spot where the antenna is resonant, lowest SWR right on the frequency that we want, 3923. All right, let's see what happens on 40 meters. Here we are on 40 meters. I've sent the antenna controller box to a preset position for around where I want to be. And now we'll just start clicking the mic and see what happens. And the radio shuts off. Turn it back on. Try one more time. Boom. Shuts off right away. Now, some of you are saying, well, your SWR is real high. That's why it's shutting down. Well, as you can see on the other bands, the SWR could be real high. It didn't matter. The radio didn't shut down. So I've done some investigating here. Let's just do a little bit more. And the first thing we'll do is reduce the power down to 25%. Or so. So we're sending out a lot less RF energy. And we'll try this again. Oh, still shutting off. Let's try reducing power a little bit more. Maybe 10%. And we're not shutting off. We can find a better SWR. For our frequency of choice right there. So the antenna can give us a good SWR, and here you can see that kind of in between what we saw on 20 meters and what we saw on 80 meters, the antenna is more broadbanded, but we still get a pretty good curve. All right, so the SWR is fine. And let's ramp up power as we transmit. As we transmit in sideband, it's not going to do anything because there's no power unless I actually talk. So we'll change the mode. CW won't work because I have to plug in a key if I wanted to operate CW. But RTTY will give us continuous carrier. And if I transmit, we'll see that I'm transmitting a continuous carrier. Again, the power is set real low, so you're not seeing very much power output. So we'll start to crank it up, and we'll see how far we can go before it shuts down. Boom, about 20%. So what's going on? Well, I can't tell. But let's eliminate the antenna system from the equation and replace it with a dummy load. There are two antenna ports on the back of the 7000. One is for VHF, which I can never remember which is which, but this one is marked antenna 2, and this one is marked HF, so it's that one. So I'm going to disconnect that antenna. And replace it with the dummy load. It's all much harder to do with one hand, with the other hand trying to hold the camera. Much harder to do. So I'm going to use two hands. Okay, the antenna is out of the equation. We are connected to the dummy load. and see what happens. Back on 40 meters, and once again, there's no antenna connected, but there is a dummy load, and we'll just click the mic to step up the band. And wow, that dummy load is good. There's no signal. I mean, there's no SWR right down there at the bottom one-to-one. And the radio is not shutting off. Go back to sideband mode, but that won't affect this. Radio is not shutting off, so we can say that the problem is only occurring when the antenna is connected. It's not a problem inside the radio. Kind of expected that, but you got to get here to test. We've also determined that it's not really an SWR issue with a high standing wave being presented to the radio, because we weren't getting a high standing wave. Well, were we or weren't we? Let's not rely on the meter that's here in the radio and put another SWR bridge in the circuit and see what happens. And that SWR bridge is actually this Diamond SX600. It's a combination watt meter and SWR meter. You might prefer to use an antenna analyzer, something that can sweep the band, generating its own little bit of RF. I don't have one, so this is what I'm going to be using. Now, in inserting the SWR bridge, the Diamond, I have actually changed the length of the feed line by a few inches. On this frequency, that shouldn't be much of a deal, but we should check just to make sure that that didn't change anything. And it didn't. Things still shut down. Okay, I've got the radio, the transmitter of the 7000 set on RTTY so I can get a carrier. I have the power level set at about 20%, which is about as high as I can go without the radio shutting down. When it's connected to the antenna, it is showing about 1.5 to 1 SWR where I've got the antenna currently set and the frequency that I'm on. And let's see if this meter agrees with that. We'll activate the carrier. We are in the calibrate mode, so we turn the calibrate dial up to the top, switch to SWR, and it agrees. 1.5 to 1. So the antenna looks okay. Just for fun, let's see what the actual power is. It's up at 250 watts just to be safe. We should only actually be putting out about 20, 25 watts, which looks like it's a little below 20. We'll go to the 20 watt position and see that, yeah, it's about 15 watts or so. Plenty to make a good SWR comparison. And for fun, we'll switch to reflected power and see that it's about a watt. So what has this told us so far? It's told me everything should be fine. The antenna is, SWR-wise, is fine on the frequency that it's causing the radio a problem. And the radio is fine on all frequencies when it's going into the dummy load. So everything's working, except it's not. Now, at this point, you're probably saying, well, he's figured it out. He knows where we're going. In this mystery, he wrote the last page, but I didn't. I don't know what's going on. Let's do something we probably should have done a little bit earlier, a visual inspection of the connections at the base of the antenna. This stuff has been on here a long time. I bought this car in 2007 and put the antennas and everything else on it within a month or so. So let's see, 2007, 17, 18, 19, 20, 22, 3, 4, 17 years. Been there a long time. It's only been disconnected a couple of times. It took the mount off to repaint it once. So everything was disconnected at that point. You know, I can barely see what I'm looking at here in the viewfinder because it's so bright and sunny out here. So things are corroded, or they're covered with a layer of corrosion, I guess. But everything seems to be still taped up pretty well. I'm not going to open it up and look inside. I think that would potentially subject it to more stress and potential damage then is warranted. Let's see what things look like deep underneath. If you can see it. Now, the coax has, you know, been out there in the weather for 17 years in some pretty harsh conditions. I don't see any cracking or anything. This choke is part of what Tarheel supplies to keep RF from going back to the control system. So, I don't know. The hypothesis then, the supposition, will be that RF is still somehow getting into the radio and causing it to shut down at that specific frequency. That seems a little strange, but what else could there be? Just, it's a guess, but it's kind of an informed guess. There's only a few paths into the radio from external connections. I see there's an external speaker connection, and of course there's the VHF antenna that's connected. So let's disconnect those and see what happens. And of course there is also the power connection. And I think that's it. Oh yeah, also the control head, your remote control head connection. I guess that's a big one. So at least for now, disconnected the external speaker and the VHF-UHF antenna. Let's just run a test and see what happens. We've got a couple of ways to make this happen. Could use the SWR test, but since I'm sitting here in RTTY mode, let's just key up and raise the power, and boom, we've shut down. So it wasn't those two external connections, and I can't disconnect the control head connection. So what's the next thing to do? Shotgun. Put chokes on everything. I got a bunch of these chokes at a ham fest a while ago, mostly to try to clear up interference up in the ham shack / studio, you know, the one in the bonus room above the garage. And I haven't really installed all of them, haven't worked on that very hard, but turns out they're useful here. So I put a choke on the power lead, choke on the antenna lead, and a choke on the control cable. Let's give it a test. And now the acid test. Keying up, raising power, 100%. Whoa, that worked. Let's do the SWR thing. Very interesting, and just for fun, K4 AAQ testing. Knocking me over with a feather. It worked. I wonder which one. So let me plug in the other things that weren't plugged in and see where we are. The VHF antenna and the speaker, and see what happens. The VHF antenna and the speaker are plugged back in. Run the little SWR curve. No shutdown. So do we want to take a few of those chokes off and isolate which one worked? Sure, why not? Let's take everything off and just leave the one on the control cable to the control head. That's my guess as to the culprit. Okay, I've removed the chokes from the power cable and from the antenna cable. The choke is still on there on the control cable. What do you think? I haven't tested this. I don't have advanced knowledge. Let's go find out. My second guess was going to be, my least guess was the power cable. But my second guess, and probably should have been my first, was the antenna cable, because, I mean, that's the RF, right? Let's see. The only choke left is on the control cable. And we are still good. Apparently that was it. My guess was correct, but it was just a guess. And a barely educated, informed guess at that. Now, there's no reason to think that what I've done has messed up anything on the other bands, but we should check just to be sure. Yeah, things are working okay on 10. 12 meters, could I dial it in a little bit, I guess. Looks good. Let's go to 15. Seems very unhappy. Ah, there it is, but way off from where the preset button was anyway on the Tarheel controller. I know what was wrong. I didn't have a preset position for 15 meters. I had it set for 17 meters. There aren't enough buttons, preset locations on the Tarheel box to do one for both 15 and 17. So I had one set for 17 and now it's set for 15. So this is going to be off, but it's only a short dial to get it tuned in. Let's look at 20 meters. My preset position on 20 looks pretty good. And 40 meters was our bugaboo, so we're sending the antenna up to 40 meters. I've got two positions on the box for 40 meters, one at 72, 51, 55, where the mid cars, east cars, south cars are located. It's broad enough to cover all those. Yeah, the preset's a little bit off, but and once again, we're working at full power. And I've got a couple of spots up on 60 meters. I think I've got one at the channel 5 position, I think. Now, it's a little dicey, technically, doing this on 60 meters because it's going to set a few blips out of the band. So if the FCC is watching, if you're a cop, you have to tell me. Get a good SWR. You like 60 meters. All right, so that's doing good, and we'll do one on 75 meters just for fun. The frequency I had in my memory is the old, current North Carolina Tarheel Emergency Net frequency. I don't get on there very much anymore, but it's what was loaded in the radio. I haven't dug into the South Carolina Aries activity. In theory, I'm there. I didn't hear much of the background noise change. Let's see what's happening. Oh, no, we're still close to resonance nearby. Yeah, it doesn't tune quite as well on 75 meters as the other bands. And as you can see, it is pretty sharp. But okay, we're working. Nothing on 160 meters. Sorry, there's no antenna for 160. Tarheel 200 doesn't do 160. So, okay, we have solved it. Now, you might remember in a previous Ham Radio Now when I was describing this problem, David W0DHG said, oh, you just need to put on a choke or two. David, mark this day on your calendar because you were right. Happy, happy. And I don't have to operate QRP on 40 meters.